Hashat Audio presents You Will Know Me, written by Megan Abbott, read by Lauren Fortgang.
For Allison Quinn. The Party. Go, Devon! Knox rocks! Next stop, elite qualifiers. Bell stars forever. Regional champs. The vinyl banners rippled from the air vent, the restaurant roiling with parents, the bobbing of gymnast heads, music gushing from the weighty speakers keeled on the window ledges. Slung around Devon's neck were three medals, two silver and one gold, her first regional champion title on the vault. I'm so proud of you, sweetie, Katie whispered in her daughter's ear. You can do anything. Later, Katie would come to think of that night as the key to everything that came after, the secret code. But at the time, it was just another party, a celebration like dozens of others, all to honor their exceptional 15-year-old daughter. In 6 months, Devon would compete in elite qualifiers, and after years of bruising toil and hamstring tears and $25,000 in credit card debt and one fateful misstep at her last qualifier, would at last assume the mantle of senior elite. From there, anything felt possible. Everything was glowing, the disco ball spinning above and the sterno lights flickering under the kebabs and lomi lomi atop long tables skirted with raffia, candles in coconut shells and pineapples that Katie had helped hollow out with ice cream scoopers. Everyone was wearing a lei in honor of the booster club's Polynesian theme, and Katie spotted Devon smelling hers, the only one made with real orchids, purple and green. The exalted Coach T having draped it over her head as she walked under the thatched arch to great applause.
Hail our Devon, he'd intoned, that big voice of his. For the future of Bellstars rests on these powerful shoulders.
It was the giddiest Katie had ever seen her daughter. Maybe it was the night, or the plastic cup of rum-spiked punch Eric let her have, offering some small release from the tight pincers that held her constantly. In a corner, her son, Drew, sat with two other quiet fourth-grade boys, eating frozen bananas dipped in chocolate, their heads craned over handheld games. He was quieter than usual, scolded earlier for spilling or pouring chocolate milk all over Devon's perfectly softened good luck grips.
But Devon never gets in trouble, he'd said. Not for that thing or doing the treadmill when she's supposed to rest her knee, not even for sneaking out at night. I never snuck out, Devon had insisted.
You were dreaming, Katie had reminded him. He was always dreaming about his sister, saying he'd heard her, seen her, doing things impossible and forbidden.
Mom, Devon was on the roof flying. Her bed was on fire, Dad.
When he was little, he used to dream she had claws for feet.
Buddy, Eric had said, let your sister have her night.
But Katie had whispered a promise to him, all the coconut cake and pineapple kebabs he wanted, as long as he behaved. By her second cocktail, fabric petals tickling her cheek, Katie had forgotten about Drew's misdeed, forgotten even about the uncomfortable moment, hours before, at the stadium. A dozen rows ahead of them in the stands, that beat-faced dad in the gym dreams cap, upset over his daughter's ranking, who'd shouted that disgusting thing.
Devon Knox! Devon sucks
only stopping mid-sentence at his wife's glare. But Eric had heard it. She could tell by the way his back stiffened, his jaw tightened. She'd grabbed for his hand, held it firmly. But the moment passed, and now Eric stood at one of the banquet tables, carving the glistening ham, pink as a newborn. Coach Teddy, a parasoled Mai Tai, impossibly dainty in his bare paw hand, pulled Katie aside and said he was counting every second until July's qualifiers, when Devon would gain senior elite status and everyone would finally see.
Because look at her, he said. Just look at our once and future champ.
And Katie did, peering through the candy-colored crowd at the poppy and cobalt of Devon's jacket, its sparkling Bell Stars logo. Less than 5 feet tall, a hard, smooth shell of a body, hipless, breastless still.
But the way she'd transformed her body in the last 2 years, thighs like trunks, shoulders and biceps straining her tank top straps, staggered Katie.
The world is hers now, is yours, is ours, Teddy said,
then diving in for a loud, rummy smack of a kiss flush on Katie's lips.
Just like I promised Katie did.
Had that really happened? It had, and it all made sense that night, the holy consummation of everything. I wish I could do what you do, Kirsten Seifert kept saying to Katie. I want it for Jordan. I want to know everything you did. If it's not too late. Have you seen Jordan's breasts? But Tansy's only 7. The music boomed louder, and soon enough the adults started dancing, taking over the playlist from the endless thump and squeal of teen pop and club music, playing every song they'd loved 15 years before, every opening chord releasing a chorus of yes and oh God, remember? And there was that remarkable conversation with the booster vice president, Molly Chu. In front of the ladies' room, Capri panted, soft-shouldered Molly, who rarely talked about anything but gymnastics and carpooling, leaned close and told Katie how, when she was a little girl, all she wanted was to be a majorette, like Erica Neubauer, the prettiest girl at Shelby West High.
I used to watch her in all the parades, marching in those red tassel booties, hurling her baton up to heaven, she said, giggling like a girl. I remember watching her and thinking, that is all I want.
And she told Katie how she'd stolen a piece of pipe from her father's tool bench, sprayed it silver, and jabbed a cork on one end.
I'd twirl in the front yard for hours, she said. It looked like a pinwheel in the sun.
She glanced at Katie, her eyes filling.
Remember that kind of wanting? That kind that's just for yourself? And you don't even have to feel guilty about it. You wouldn't know you should.
Katie nodded and nodded and nodded, because it felt true even if she couldn't name the things she'd wanted. But something. Looking around, she wondered, was it this? In front of them, a group of the littlest girls, still in their leotards, they never liked to take them off, started dancing in a circle together, chins lifted high and faces pink like ice cream.
It's free, then,
Molly said, watching the girls, tilting her head and blinking fast.
It's never free again.
What? Katie said, because she'd lost the thread, if she'd ever had it. What? But the music swallowed them, and then someone brought out a tray of shots, flaming. Later, she found herself dancing with Eric, which hadn't happened in years, since that night they'd snuck to the hotel bar after a tops meet, Devon and Drew asleep upstairs. That lounge singer, inexplicably crooning, smells like teen spirit. Eric had always been a terrific dancer, and the championship and the lanterned loveliness of the old catering hall, they all enlivened him. His smile and his fingers moved so delicately, his arm grabbing her so firmly, and didn't everyone in the hall look at them? A thought came to her rum-soaked head.
He's never loved me more than this.
Because of Devon. Because of Devon. Something else I owe Devon. But they were changing partners, and Molly, who would later pass out in the wrong car, wiggled over, lassoed Eric, while Katie, who was tired anyway, ambled toward the ladies' room looking for Devon or Drew. When she returned, there was Coach T spinning his wife, Tina, around, a splotch of maraschino on her immaculate white shirt. And the starry new arrivals, Coach's niece, Haley, yanking at the hand of that boyfriend of hers, Ryan Beck, both of them so tanned and love-blissed. This would be the piece that mattered most later, months later, when Ryan was gone. She would think of their arrival and wonder why she hadn't seen it all coming. But who could have seen anything at all that night but their bright, spangled beauty? Haley, the favored junior tumbling coach, blonde and magnificent, towering 5'7", was beloved by her 8 and 9-year-olds. Kiss those knees, sweetheart, she'd tell them as they did their back hip circles, all of whom stared at her now from the corner, gaping at her lanky prettiness as if it were an achievement to strive for, after nailing the front tuck before the back layout. and Ryan, whose appearance sent all the girls into satellites.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.